He was known to spike his cleats, or not spike, sharpen his cleats, so he would go in sliding. He would kind of raise his foot so he'd take out the third baseman or the catcher, whoever was trying to block the plate. There were some pretty bad stories about him. I'm not going to go into, you know, some of them are pretty bad. I'm not going to go into those over here. Now over here, we have four paintings. We have Ted Williams over here and Lou Gehrig. Now, Ted Williams is very close to the Hillerick family. There were a number of years there where Ted, he actually lived right across from the Hillericks when the Hillericks had one of their homes down in Florida. Now, Ted was so particular about his bats that he would actually come here to the factory. He'd pick out his own timber. We call it a billet. We'll show you those downstairs. And Ted really only liked the one factory worker here making his bats. Now, this is at a time before machinery. Today, we crank out bats in 30 seconds. Years ago, they were made one at a time on a hand-turning lathe. But we had a guy here by the name of Fritz Bickel. Guy worked here for 50 years making bats. Started here. He was 14 years old back in 1912. But Ted would come down here to the factory, he'd look for Fritz, he'd tip him like 10 bucks, and then Fritz would let Ted go through the billets and he'd pick out which ones he wanted. Today that picky player is Joey Votto for the Reds. Votto, factory guys, will line up billets, take pictures of them, text message them to Joey, and he'll pick out which ones he wants. So that's Joey Votto today. All right, and then back over here, we have a couple of Negro League legends over here. We have John Jordan over here, better known as Buck O'Neill.
Yes, exactly. Who knows who that was?
Great early ambassador for baseball, first African-American coach, and he worked with the Chicago Cubs. Actually, he found and signed Ernie Banks to a contract when Banks was a young player there. And then over here, probably one of the best pitchers of all time, Leroy Satchel Paige. And anybody know how he got the nickname Satchel?
I'm trying to remember.
It was because when he was a kid, he used to work as like a bellhop at a hotel.
Right.
And he would always carry people's satchel, and he could carry so many of them, so they just called him Satchel. Actually, one of Satchel Paige's nephews works here.
Really?
His nephew Charles. Actually, I think Charles is here today. I saw him earlier. I don't know if he's still, he was here earlier today.
Wow.
Charles is one of his, I don't know if it's his nephew or his great, it might be a great nephew. Because Charles is a little bit younger.
I was going to ask, as far as the Negro League baseball league was concerned, as far as, were they given Louisville bats?
We signed, the first player we signed to a contract was with in the Negro Leagues. He was actually from Cuba. His name just escapes me right now, but he's in the Hall of Fame. His name just escaped me right now. But Jackie Robinson, we actually signed Jackie before he broke in with the Brooklyn Dodgers.
Really?
We signed Jackie in 1946, and he didn't break in with the Dodgers until 1947, so we signed Jackie early on. I can't remember that Cuban guy's name right now. It'll come to me later on. I'll think about it at some point today. All right, now if
these are beautiful, especially since they're from my hometown.
And a lot of these paintings, the guy who did these, a lot of them are in the Hall of Fame, so these are, you know, fairly well-known paintings. And then here, Germany. He has no idea what a baseball even is. He actually turned away, early on, we turned away ball players who wanted bats. He would turn, they would come knocking on the door, and he would say, we don't make baseball bats, we make butter churns. That's what he thought the future of the company was. But luckily, his son Bud, who was kind of the black sheep of the family, kind of ignored his dad and continued to make the bats for the players. And by the time the early 1900s rolled around, we completely stopped making the butter churns. I think the last butter churn we made, I think, was like in 1905. So it's been a very long time since we made those butter churns. Yeah. All right. Well, so we'll head back out this way, and we'll take you folks into the factory next.
Yep. stairs or there?
I mean, people can go down the elevator if they want, but everybody's fine with it. I think when we came up, it was kind of like half and half.
It's like so unpredictable.
If anybody wants to take the elevator, we're going to walk into, we're going to take elevator or stairs, whatever, your choice. What do you think? We're going to do stairs? Okay, so everybody come follow me down this way. We'll take you to the back.
As long as it's not like 20
minutes. No, I'm just going to go down one floor. I remember the name. It was Martin Tahiga. Too bad, I mean, to do anything with this. So a lot lot of those bats end up actually being firewood, or they get grounded down, and they end up going to animal bedding. Actually, a turkey farmer from southern Indiana comes down once a week and takes all their sawdust and uses it as bedding. We'll generate about 10,000 pounds of sawdust here every day. So average week here is like 50, 60,000 pounds. All right, well, so we'll get the doors open here. We'll kind of gather. There's a yellow box in here, so we'll kind of gather in there. We're going to play a little film, and we'll tell you a little more about the timber and where it all comes from.
All right, so as you go to our next stop, be sure to check out the picture of Bud.
they can smell it. They smack the old high school. How we get it here to Louisville. And here at the first stop, this is our billet holding station. We got thousands of them behind me here getting ready to be turned into retail, minor league, major league player beds within the next week or so. And then in front here, this is our team wall. We have every team here represented for each team. These are some of the more loyal guys for each ball club that we have. So there are other companies out there that make bats for major leaguers. Right now we have about 35 competitors. So we're not the only game in town. A lot of competition today. I know, let's see, we're the teams again. We had Cubs. I think you said somebody said Cubs. Let's see, we'll pass around. Here's a Schwarber billet. You know, were you a White Sox fan though? Or, okay, you may not want the Cubs one. You'll take the Cubs one here. We'll give you Adam Engel. Adam Engel here. I think he's actually playing in the minors right now. And that's a birch billet. And a very interesting cylindrical piece of wood, right? Yeah, 37 inches long, 3 inches in diameter. These do vary in weight, but typically they're between 80 and 90 ounces. Here's an ash billet. There's Joey Votto there for the Reds. So ash, maple, and birch, these are the three woods that players use today for their bats. But they're not all evenly used. Maple by far is the wood of choice today for bats. Right around 80% of players today are swinging maple. That's the type of bats they were back in the old days. About 15% use birch, only about 5% use ash. Ash is really falling out of favor with the players, which, to be honest, we really don't mind, because right now there's a little bug on around the country, the Emerald Ash Borer. Yeah, it's already killed millions of ash trees, kind of came down from Michigan. It's kind of spreading out throughout the Midwest. So there might be a point in the not-too-distant future where we can't even make ash bats anymore. But thankfully, the players, they really do prefer the maple, because it is a very dense wood. Maple's about 20% more dense than ash. So your power hitters, your Aaron Judges and Bryce Harpers, Mike Trouts, these are the guys swinging the maple. Big drawback to maple, though, since it is such a dense wood, not a lot of flexibility. Those are the bats that typically shatter into a million pieces when they break. I'm sure folks seen this occasionally. Now, we do have some better testing now in place than we did even 10 years ago to make sure the players are getting the high-quality stuff and to make sure that's not all happening. Now, I do want to point out, remember we saw in the video there, Bobby Dilworth, who's a fifth-generation bat maker with us here. Well, in this picture here, these are three of Bobby's relatives, picture taken back in 1958. Actually, on the far left, that's Bobby's dad. That's his dad, Hart. Unfortunately, Hart did pass away at a very young age. He passed back in 1985. He was only about 42 years old. In the center there, that's John Hiller Jr., who's president from 1949 up until 1969 when he passed. And when he passed on, that's when his other son took over, Bobby's uncle. That's John Dillard III. And he's still here today. He's the chairman, but he was president from 69 up until 2001. And it's right now his son who's our president, John Dillard IV. And John Dillard IV has his son. Anybody want to guess his name? It's actually Steve. Okay, it is John. Yeah, John Dillard V, but we all call him Quinn. And then we're talking about, I was talking a little bit about upstairs about the picky players, Ted Williams, Joey Votto in particular. We had to put them here in the factory. We talked about them here in the factory a little bit. Now Ted, one time he even sent his bats back, they're off and it handles by 5/1000ths of an inch. And again, this is where we're making bats by hand. That was old hand training. It just take 30 minutes to make a bat. The machines now will do that same bat in about 30 seconds. So we went from 30 minutes of bat to 30 seconds of bat.
All right, so any of these bills, we'll take back for you folks here. And actually, and I mentioned with Votto, you know, we'll send him pictures of his billets. But it's not even uncommon for us to drive his bats up to Cincinnati. There'll be many times, you know, Cincinnati's only like an hour and a half away. So actually, one of our pro guys upstairs, he's driving bats to Ryan Zimmerman, I think later tomorrow. So we'll be taking his bats up there for the Washington Nationals. Any other bills we got floating around here? We got them all? All right, we got a couple back. Oh, we got them all, okay. So what we'll do now is we're going to take you folks down to the next stop. We'll show you how we turn these billets into major league player bats.
Actually, I think we are still thinking some bats today.
So come join me over here. Well, we've only got this machine running right now, so we'll kind of gather around the machine over here.
Actually, we've got both machines up and running.
Actually, the guy running them right now is Brian Hillworth. He's the great grandson of Bud Hillworth, who made our first bat in 1984. So that's who's making the bats right now. So get descendants of the first guy who actually made our first bat. And I think they're making Kyle Schwarber bats, actually. I see his name on the dry erase board over there. Yeah, so these two machines, we have the brown one and the red one behind us. These are the computerized lathes, our CNC lathes, where we do make all the bats for the major leaguers. So when you folks go to a game, you watch a game on TV, see a player holding a slugger, it would have been made off of one of these two machines. So the only two machines in the world that make major league Louisville Slugger bats. Now the machines here, all the bat models are stored directly on the computers of the lathe. We store thousands of them, about three to 4,000 models we store on here. Just pushing a couple of buttons, we can make a bat for any player. You know, you think of. And here, we'll pass around a few bats here. Here's a Josh Harrison, that's a birch bat for the Tigers. Pass him around. Here's Ronald Acuna Jr. for the Braves, it's a maple bat. And here's Adam Jones. Out the Diamondbacks, that's an ash bat. Look at that one going. Now, your average ball player today, they're going to order from us. It's typically between 80 to about 120 bats in a season. You know, Derek Jeter, I'm sure all of you know that name, right? Yeah. Throughout Derek's career, he ordered about 4,000 bats from us. Want to guess how many of them he actually paid for? Yeah, zero, yeah. I'll be honest, major leaguers, these guys, they don't pay for their bats. Yeah, their teams will. When you're a big leaguer, it's equipment, it's part of the job. And what we'll charge for a bat, for an ash bat, it's about $80. We do charge a bit more for the maple and birch. These are about $100 a pop. Main reason being is we have a test of quality that would have been better. Now, if you look at two of the three bats going around, you might notice how it has that little dot of ink on the handle of the bat. You see that there? So about 10 years ago, MLB implemented this new test that all the bat companies had to perform on the bats called the slope of grain or ink dot test. This maple and birch, very difficult to grain by the naked eye. So we'll drop a dot of ink right on the handle of the bat, kind of let that soak into the grain a little bit so we can see the grain lines better. And from there, the factory guys will take out their protractors and they're going to measure up the grain lines within the ink dot. If the grain lines are sloped, plus or minus 3 degrees in either direction, it means that the grain lines in the wood aren't straight enough, the bat's not high quality enough, we can't send this to a major leaguer. Or we could get fined. Just like they go around testing guys for steroids, and they'll go around checking for that ink dot. And it has helped. Since we started doing that ink dot test, the amount of shattered bats has been cut in half. So it's been a very good tool for us. All right, let's talk about some rules with a major league bat. Maximum length. Your bat can actually be up to 42 inches in length. Now, to our knowledge, no player's ever used a 42-inch bat. Most today are between 33 to 35 inches. Weight of the bat, there's no rule. Your bat can be as heavy as you like. Most of them today, 31 to 33 ounces, but the heaviest bat consistently used by a major leaguer, Hall of Fame outfielder Ed Rausch. He played for the Reds 100 years ago. Ed used a 48-ounce bat. So his bat was about a pound heavier than one. Pretty good there with that bat there. So about a pound heavier than any guy uses today. Now, for the diameter of the bats, the barrel, this can't be more than 2.61 inches in diameter. Handle can't be less than 0.86 inches in diameter. Other than that, one soft piece of wood. We do have a few rules when it comes to label placement. We'll talk a little bit more about that later on. And then on a couple of these bats going around, you might notice I got that little hole in the top of the barrel. Yeah, very common today. It's called cup balancing. And what we'll do here, remove about 3/4 of an ounce of wood right up from the top of the barrel.
This is just lighting the bat up for the player a bit, make it a little less confident. Yeah, and a couple pictures, we'll point out that one. That guy in that photo, that's Bud Hillerick. He made our first bat in 1884. That picture's taken in 1944, 2 years before his passing. Actually, Bud, he was such a big baseball fan. He went to every World Series. He knew everybody. He actually vacationed with Babe Ruth's family. And Bud, when he passed, he was actually on his way to the baseball winter meetings, and he died at the Palmer House in Chicago. Yeah, that's where the hotel that he passed away over there. Another thing I'll point out here, you know, from time to time we'll get major leaguers coming in here for a visit. So when they do, we'll have them start, have them sign the machine here. We started doing this about 5 years ago. We got some great players up here. The very first player we had sign the machine was Josh Hamilton about 5 years ago. Latest player was Nomar Garciaparra there, the old Red Sox Cubs Dr. Shortstop. He was here about 3 weeks ago. We got a bunch of Hall of Famers. We got Andre Dawson, Ozzie Smith, George Brett, Frank Thomas for your White Sox people. There's Dave Winfield, Johnny Bench. You got the reigning MVP, Christian Yelich. One of my favorites over here, Manny Ramirez. So we're adding to that, slowly but surely over there. All right, well, we got all the bats back. So follow me down to the next stop. We're getting to the retail side of things next.
Where's George Brett's signature?
Oh, George Brett?
There.
Yeah, right over here.
We do aluminum bats. We do about 2.5 million aluminum bats a year, but they're done overseas.
No, it's just wood.
Yeah.
Oh,
you
come on down, we'll talk about the machines on your left, on your left-hand side behind the plexiglass, but I'll point out a couple other things we got going on around over here. So throughout the factory floor, you'll see we have these old advertising emblems. This will be asking, signing players to contracts, what does that really entail? Well, it's really more for us, because we could do things like this, use the player's image and their name in advertising. And again, the very first player we ever signed was Homer Swagger. We signed him back in 1905. This guy over here, this is Napoleon Lajoie. He was a great early hitter for the Cleveland Indians. Now, if you turn around, too, you'll see we have those three photographs there on the back wall. Those are probably three of my favorite pictures here in the factory. Now, the one on the left, taken during World War II in 1943, today was actually, 75 years ago, D-Day. We had a couple things out in the museum yesterday and today for that. But, all the guys that worked here in the factory, they went overseas, so the women started, doing the factory work. But if you notice, they're not making baseball bats in that picture. Yeah, they're working on gun stocks. Yeah, one out of every four M1s in World War II was fitted by a gun stock made by us. Yeah, so that's, we also did police billy clubs too. We did millions of those. Now on the far right there, that's a picture just in the early factory days. It's dated there, 1903. Now that's at a time when our machines were steam powered. We would actually use all the wood shavings to power all the lathes and all the other machinery. Problem with that is, we've had a few early fires in our factory. There's a very bad one in 1910. It cost about $50,000 in damages, and that was in 1910 money. There's another bad one in 1932. So early on, we've had a few bad fires there early on. Now, the center picture there, we got those two guys highlighted. That guy in the doorway, that's Bud Hillerick, who made our first bat there for Pete Browning back in 1884. And the guy standing on the left there that's highlighted, that's J.F. Hillerick, our initial founder from 1856. Now, if you look over to J.F.'s left, the third guy in from the left, remember I was talking about how Ted Williams had his own personal hand turner, Fritz Bickle? Well, that guy's actually Fritz's dad. That's Henry Bickle. They called him Pa. He started working here in 1880. Yeah, there's a lot of family lineage here. We actually have an older woman who works at the front desk on Fridays and Saturdays. Her name is Lina. She's worked here for 67 years. Yeah, her grandfather worked here too. Her grandfather started working here in the 1880s. Another great piece of history we have here in the factory that we still use every single day for production, these old looking wheelbarrows. These things are over 100 years old. Ty Cobb's back have been on there, Babe Ruth, all the early greats. We refer to those as the Batmobiles. Those are the original ones. All right, so here, we'll pass around a few bats, so we'll kind of talk about what's going on here behind the plexiglass. Here you guys can pass those around. They're labeled, some are sanded, some are unsanded, which kind of get a feel for each one before they go through the sander or not. So over here behind the plexiglass, and I'll play a video for all of you because it looks like production's kind of down on the machine here for the rest of the day. But this is our Hempel production lathe, where we do make a lot of the bats for the minor leaguers, bats that you folks will be able to purchase in retail, sporting goods stores. Now, depending on the time of the year, but an average day here, we'll produce anywhere between 2,500 to about 4,000 bats. That's in a day. Now, whereas on the computerized lathes, the models are stored just right on the computers. Here, the models are based off of these template patterns, and they're shaped like half a bat. So the blades, when they're cutting out the bat here, is traced over the template. That's how we can shape the bat. And then factory guys, what they'll do, behind each one of the lathes, we have three in the front here, we have another two in the back. And these lathes are pretty old. These date back to the early 1960s. But we'll load about 300 billets behind each lathe. Billet will drop into the lathe one by one. Lathe will then spin that billet 3,000 rotations per minute. And then we have a series of five blades. Just make one pass across the billet, so it's that template pattern. Pretty much in 30 seconds, we'll have a bat. And when they're done, you'll see like a couple that you're passing around, they got those little nubs pegged on the ends. Of course, eventually we will cut them off. But in the meantime, their job is to hold the bat to the machinery. So when these bats are done, they'll work their way down the conveyor belt, hit the sander behind it. Sander's going to grab onto the pegs instead of the bat. And then later on in production, you know, we don't need them anymore. We'll just simply, you know, cut them right off. And then the sawdust, the wood shavings, I kind of mentioned that, how it all goes to a turkey farmer. But eventually everything will just get sucked right up to the yellow vacuum hoses there. We'll collect everything in the back of the factory. Giant truck parked out back. And Dean Wagler, the turkey farmer, he'll come down. Actually, he'll be here tomorrow. Friday's a normal pickup day. So he'll be here sometime early tomorrow. Take all the wood shavings back to his farm and use it as bedding. That's everything goes to a turkey farmer now from southern Indiana. All right, now in a second here, we're going to turn. My mic keeps cutting out here. The second, we're going to turn the corner here, and we're going to talk a little bit about labeling. There's a lot of different methods we have with that. Now, also here we have this yellow machine. We're going to walk in front of there in a second, but that's our combination machine. What that'll do for us is it'll cut off the bat nubs, it'll sand the bat.
This is Roosevelt Auto Network. We're here at the Louisville Slugger Museum. We're down here in the bat production area. Hopefully you're enjoying the walkthrough, the live stream from the Louisville Slugger Museum in Louisville, Kentucky.
This is our labeling department. We have a bunch of different methods we have here to label our bats. Directly behind me here, this is our mini bat labeling area. You know, mini bats are very popular. We'll do close to a million mini bats a year. And whereas the big bats are made from big billets, mini bats made from mini billets. And they've been, you know, we'll do it for all the teams. The one that they've been doing the last day or two, these are pretty cool. And so on June 29th and June 30th, the Yankees are playing the Red Sox, which is a big deal. They play each other 19 times a year. But they're playing the games in London. Yeah, they're actually going to England. They're gonna be playing a couple games over there, so these bats will be shipped overseas. And these bats are labeled with a process called pad printing, the mini bats. We have the pad printers over here to my left. They're kind of disassembled right now, but it's pretty much like a giant stamp. And whatever logo we'll put on the bat, here's some for the Oakland Athletics. Just stamp that logo onto the bat, and these will pretty much dry instantly. And then from there, they're gonna go through the wrapping machine, plastic wrap, go through a 400 degree oven, and that'll shrink wrap the plastic onto the bat. So that's for the mini bats. Now for the full-size bats, there's a few different methods we label those with. My favorite method is the old school method, the old firm grinding technique, where we actually take a bat, roll it over a couple of template patterns, one of the Slugger logo, one of the player's name. Both of these heat up to 1300 degrees. We'll take the bat, roll it right over, burn the logos into the bat. And actually, behind you guys over there, that's one of the firm branding machines. Another thing is when we label these bats, every single bat has to be labeled by hand. Yeah, because when they're labeled, label always goes on the weakest part of the wood. And with an ash bat, it'll be where that V-shaped grain line of wood forms. So the wooden bat, always the proper way to hold it.
Bat, what you're hearing is in the background is some information about how bats are made and labeled here at the Louisville Slugger Museum. This is Roosevelt. I hope you enjoyed the show up to this point. I'm going to end the broadcast, and as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Buckle up. Don't stream and drive. Buckle up. Don't text and drive. See you next time.
For the Red Sox. Now with the maple and birch, we can't really burn brand those. Maple and birch don't handle 1300 degrees that well. That's where laser engraving plays a big role. And up until a couple years ago, we did a lot of sticker decals for the logo. The problem with the stickers,